first time in history, more people live in cities than in the countryside. As our global population increases, this will lead either to catastrophe or salvation. Architect Paolo Soleri has a vision of what salvation might be.
It would be very hard to imagine any kind of civilization or cultural development divorced by the phenomenon of the city, because in a way it's that environment that that seems to be producing the impulse in singular minds to come up with new inventions, new applications of things, new discoveries, and eventually new creations.
In Paolo Soleri's view, our current patterns of city development are fundamentally flawed. Urban sprawl and its detrimental effects on communities and the environment are what Soleri has dedicated his life to changing.
We're asking for trouble. We're destroying our urban environments, and they will decay. These low-density environments will decay over time. What we need to do is to bring higher intensities and densities together, to bring land uses close together, as opposed to separating land uses out from each other, which we have done.
I always admired Soleri because in architecture, like in any art form or even craft form, you have to have poets. There has to be people out there scratching around looking for direction, really testing new waters that the general body of architects just can't afford to do, or they don't have the time or the skill or the talent to do.
So what has always attracted me to Paolo Soleri's work is his refusal to buy into either the current degradation of the city, and also not buying into the Arcadian view that you leave the city and go out and live in the wilderness to escape all of the evil.
I think his idea of, you know, of the city in many respects is not that visionary. It's just about reality of what cities have always had to be through time, and he's trying to bring us a way of creating cities with our culture, with our technology, that's appropriate.
Cities, unique complex entities, constructed over a span of generations, they embody the cultural, technological, and spiritual achievements of the human species. Our human evolutionary path has progressed from the tribe to the city, from the rural to the urban. But during the last 200 years, cities around the globe have undergone incredible growth. It took from all of history until the early 1800s for a city to reach a population of over 1 million. Only 200 years later, as we approach the 21st century, there are nearly 300 cities with over 1 million inhabitants. During this intensive urbanization process, we've become increasingly isolated from the natural world. Consequently, we are now at the point that our lifestyles and our dominant technologies threaten to destroy the web of life that sustains us. This accelerating process of social alienation and ecological destruction is a recent phenomenon. In the early part of this century, strong communities based on the neighborhood developed within our cities. Most people walked or used trolley systems for transportation. The development was of a human scale. But as populations grew and the automobile began to dominate, a new type of development became popular.
Then after World War II, the automobile was certainly very evident in our society. And from the automobile, we started building roads outside of this very compact type of urban area called suburbia. And since then, America has spread out instead of built up. And we've lost a great sense of community by the spreading out of America.
In suburbia, what were once farms and natural habitats have been paved over and segregated into separate residential, commercial, and industrial corridors. The large distances between these zones makes walking impractical and makes the use of the automobile necessary. This increasing flight of people and capital into the suburbs puts a strain on city infrastructures. This, in turn, causes the urban core to deteriorate into areas of hopelessness, poverty, and crime. The city of Phoenix, Arizona, experienced these problems as it grew from a small city to a major urban area in just a few decades.
But I think it's become clear to those of us that are in Phoenix now, that are in leadership positions, that we are in fact on the same continuum as all these other cities, where we have a central city and a tax base which is leaving us, which doesn't allow us to simply pay the bills, doesn't allow us to take care of the human resources that we need to have, doesn't allow us to do things like transit systems. So we've got a resource problem in a city because those resources have left to go to the suburbs.
While policymakers debate ways to address these problems, architect Paolo Soleri proposes a distinct alternative to urban sprawl. Soleri believes that cities can be designed in a way so that the vitality of urban life is increased without destroying the natural world that surrounds and sustains the urban habitat. His ideas are fundamentally different from other architects because he envisions the city as a complex living organism. Soleri calls this new paradigm for urban planning arcology.
The better use you make of what's available, the better the situation is going to be. So since arcology is fundamentally, when it's well designed, I don't pretend to be a good designer, but when it's well designed, would deliver more for the buck, let's say, or for the amount of material or energy used, then it's quite evident as an instrument would be a very positive instrument.
Soleri's arcology merges the discipline of architecture with the science of ecology in an attempt to create a socially and environmentally sustainable city.
That a city is like an organism. And the key that I think Soleri has probably been one of the real forefronts of trying to help define for us is looking at the city as kind of a sustainable organism, and what is it we need to take in order to survive and be strong, and what is it we don't need to take in, what is it that we take in that's harmful to us. And if we can define those elements more accurately, and many of those things are economically driven, I think we've got a much greater opportunity for a sustainable city that in which everybody prospers.
And while many designers have proposed new urban schemes, Paolo Soleri is constructing his city. He calls it Arcosanti. Soleri's development of this revolutionary urban form had its beginnings in the late 1940s. After receiving his PhD in architecture from the Turin Polytechnic Institute in his native Italy, Soleri came to the southwestern United States to apprentice at Frank Lloyd Wright's Taliesin School of Architecture. While Soleri was inspired by Mr. Wright's philosophy of organic architecture, he was equally impressed by the integrated community life that was the basis of the Taliesin Fellowship. This experience would later help motivate him to design entire cities rather than individual buildings.
Yeah, but when I was at Taliesin, I wasn't thinking about arcologies and all those things. I was just absorbing and doing my little things that I was asked to do. I was very grateful to be able to have that experience, and it was very, very important for me.
After leaving Taliesin in 1948, Soleri was given the opportunity to design and build a unique desert home called the Dome House. He also married his client's daughter, Collie Woods, who was assisting in the construction. Soon after, they left the United States and traveled throughout Europe, where in Italy, Soleri was commissioned to build a ceramics factory. The Soleris returned to Arizona in 1955 and established a windbell crafting business in the desert just outside of Phoenix. The growing sales of these unique sculptured bells gave Soleri enough financial independence to pursue theoretical work in architecture. He established the Cosanti Foundation, an educational center for research in architecture and urban planning. His 5-acre home site soon became an architectural proving ground for experiments in human habitat design.
since the soil in the desert is very homogeneous, it's very nice. I start cutting holes in the ground to make bells. And then some bells got quite big. And then I start thinking, well, what about using concrete and make a roof instead of making a bell? So that's how the sealed cast came about.
I can fondly remember in 1968 when we started construction on the new drafting room, and we went and got a bunch of pajama flannel at a local fabric store, and working with Paulo and catenary chains and rolled curved forms to develop a formwork, which as we looked at it was, you know, driven by economy and logic of you know, I think there's so much to learn from Paulo in somebody accomplishing so much with so little. It's taking literally almost nothing and turning it into magic.
In 1965, Soleri received the prestigious Guggenheim Fellowship. It provided him the opportunity to work on the design of a complete urban complex called Mesa City. Although still two-dimensional in its approach, Mesa City became the basis for an entirely new urban form, the arcology. Arcologies. Bold, complex, and imaginative, these three-dimensional city structures drew international attention to Soleri and his ideas. Soleri designed numerous arcologies in a variety of sizes, placing them on both land and sea and in various climatic conditions. He saw the arcology as the next evolutionary step in the design of cities.
I guess arcology to me means that the world could have the best of both the natural and the man-made. I think that the idea of an arcology and what it does in sort of common sense efficiency and creating a quality of urban existence, the potentials of that, with the poetry of existing in a natural setting, and to see that really manifested would really be a wonderful thing.
Soleri defied convention again when he applied the tenets of arcology to the design of innovative dam and bridge cities. These arcologies will house entire communities and act as cultural bridges as well as physical connectors. Soleri's concepts continued to evolve. He looked to worlds beyond the Earth and began developing space-based arcologies. The primary design imperatives of arcology are complexity and miniaturization. They will be essential in sustaining human colonies in the harshness of outer space. Soleri's arcology is the antithesis of suburban sprawl. He believes that these dense living cities will maximize the benefits of urban life while minimizing the use of land, raw materials, and energy.
There are elements in the composition of the city which are very negative. And one element is the waste of space, which translates into a waste of resources and waste of time, and ultimately the waste of the people.
To reduce the city's land area, Soleri designs his cities to rise up rather than expand out. In contrast to sprawling cities, an arcology is a large, integrated, self-contained structure. Its compact design allows agricultural land and biologically diverse habitats to remain preserved beyond the perimeter of the city.
One of the best ways I think we can change and reduce our impacts to our environment is by land use. Land use in and of and by itself can solve these problems. And that land use as a higher concentration is mixed-use type of development. And Paulo's idea is mixed-use in its purest sense, putting a variety type of uses in one building.
Environmental concerns are central to Soleri's design philosophy. Current design and construction practices have resulted in cities that are voracious consumers of energy. Much of that energy is generated by fossil or nuclear fuels. An arcology is different. Due to its innovative structural design, an arcology would have most of its heating and cooling needs met through passive solar techniques. The American love affair with the car has been responsible for the present development patterns of American cities. Streets and parking lots dominate the urban space. Being stuck behind the wheel creates isolation and frustration. And as our cities grow more complex, the social and environmental costs of the automobile will continue to escalate.
The more we multiply the presence of the automobile, the more we find out that this freedom becomes curtailed to a point where, for instance, in many cities, it becomes an hindrance, really an obstacle. And that doesn't speak about the real problem with the automobile, which is waste, pollution, cost, and all those things that are coming with it.
Soleri does not merely seek to minimize the use of automobiles. He calls for the total elimination of the car from within the city. Inside the arcology, Soleri pictures an integrated system of elevators, escalators, and moving walkways that will promote convenient pedestrian travel as the primary method of mobility. Soleri believes his designs will decrease the alienation and isolation that plague so many city dwellers today. In a bold attempt to reintegrate people with their communities, Soleri has designed his arcologies as large, mixed-use complexes containing homes, offices, schools, shops, parks, and cultural centers. Soleri believes this close interaction of city functions and people will induce a greater sense of community within an arcology.
In an arcology, the integration of working and living and recreation is such that all of these things become a very natural part of everyday living. It's not something you have to take a child to see, to do, but rather something he or she experiences in normal everyday life.
Even though Soleri is concerned with cultural development, he does not have any preconceived plans about how a society within an arcology should be administered, be it socially, politically, or economically.
My metaphor is always the piano. We are trying to build a piano, but unless you get some good musicians, the piano is going to be idle, or the piano is going to be irrelevant. So the physical environment can go so far, and carrying on the metaphor, the piano doesn't tell you what kind of music you have to play. You just have to play music naturally, which the piano can express, but beyond that, you can play any kind of music.
The miniaturization of the city, bringing about higher population density, is to many the most controversial aspect of the arcology concept.
So if you want to be true with the nature of life, you have to remember that the coming together is where life gets its own reality. And the distribution of life comes with death. And to me, when you have a city which tends to be pulled together and suddenly is breaking down into a suburban sprawl, that to me is a dying process.
Can society develop and flourish within a city like the ones Soleri has proposed? That question can only be answered after an arcology is built. In 1970, Soleri took a courageous step, putting his years of theory to the test when he began construction on an arcology. Located on a desert mesa in central Arizona, the city of Arcosanti will require only 15 acres of land to house a community of 5,000 people. A comparable suburban development would use approximately 500 acres. The surrounding 860-acre site contains orchards, agricultural fields, and a nature preserve consisting of canyons, high desert foothills, and lush riparian habitats. As the world's first arcology, Soleri envisions Arcosanti as an urban laboratory where his design theories can be refined and tested. This unique effort was undertaken without the financing needed by such an ambitious construction project. It is being built, much like other Soleri endeavors, with determination and idealism. While only a small percentage of Arcosanti's master plan has been completed, several unique and visually stunning structures have been built. These buildings are intended to serve as the platform for a growing community that will continue to build the larger arcology.
What he's tried to do here, and I think successfully, at least as a model, is to give us and not just a vision, but an actual feeling and a sample for what genuine urban life would be like with the environment not only respected, but nurtured and brought into the urban experience. I think to that extent, it's really quite unique. From my point of view, a very hopeful vision of the future.
The design for the Arizona Arcology changed several times as Soleri refined his architectural concepts. The Arcosanti 2000 model is the latest evolution in his life's work. Arcosanti 2000 is also a plan for a complex that Soleri believes could be built within an existing city, as an urban village or a satellite community.
Paolo has proposed to have two semi-curved vaulted buildings, one 30-story and one 15-story, and it's pointed towards the sun and collects the sun's energy, so it's very environmentally efficient. So the design itself is quite different, and it's warm. It's not a sterile type of environment as you have with slabs of tall buildings going up, which we do all over the United States. He would have all the different cultural facilities, retail facilities, be large recreation areas, green spaces, park areas, bring in water features into that that whole area. On the backside would be a series of gardens, be a series of orchards and trees. It is really meshing an urban environment with an agricultural environment. Quite unique in the United States, quite unique and probably in the world.
When completed, Arcosanti holds the promise of being the most efficient and environmentally benign city ever built. But for now, many of Soleri's ideas remain on the drafting table. Because Arcosanti lacks the budget to undertake large-scale construction, progress has been slow. Consequently, the building of this new city has taken a more grassroots approach. Over the years, thousands of people from around the world have participated in the construction of Arcosanti. They pay a tuition fee to participate in workshops, which include lectures and hands-on building experience in the apprenticeship tradition.
It's an incredible cosmopolitan spot. And on that level, that's what Paul, I think in many reasons, is what Arcosanti is trying to be and what Arcology is trying to be, a place where many different cultures and many different ideas can come together and help to generate a new culture and a new concept of how people live not only on the earth but with each other. And in that level, it's a tremendous success.
Permanent living quarters are in short supply for many of Arcosanti's residents. Most live in Spartan-like conditions and work in construction, the foundries, the cafe, or as tour guides. The site, however, is not without certain amenities.
It's just a really positive sort of direction for our society to be taking. The situation that we're living in isn't typical of how it will be when it's completed, but it's workable. And I think that it's a lot of fun. I mean, my workshop was a gas.
Those apartments that have been completed demonstrate that a home in an arcology can be as comfortable and beautiful as those found in any other apartment or condominium. Design and construction are not Soleri's only areas of concentration. Since its inception, he has infused the community with an artistic and cultural spirit. Arts and music festivals have always played a significant part in the Arcosanti experience. Regular concerts are presented at the Colli Soleri Music Center, as are educational programs and other cultural events. Compared to Soleri's goal of a city for 5,000, the reality at Arcosanti today is a modest showing. The number of inhabitants fluctuates, but rarely exceeds 100. And despite the hard work of many people, there is much uncertainty about the future of Arcosanti.
When you look at the models and the visions and look at the perspective of that, the idealism that Arcosanti represents to me is the greatest contribution at this point. And yet the sadness is that there isn't a significant enough hole here that we can get a momentum going in the community or the culture to see that reality. So it's very bittersweet.
Funding for the city's ongoing construction has come almost entirely from the worldwide sales of Soleri bells and tourism, which are Arcosanti's only industries. Soleri's grassroots approach to building the city has allowed him to maintain control over its development, but his independence has come with a price. Today, Arcosanti remains more village than city, and it is still struggling to become economically self-sustaining.
And if you have a democracy or in a capitalistic system working together, it doesn't really encourage community living. And so to do that, you have to go against the grain, or you have to find a new way. And then when you do that, you find problems with financing.
Although Soleri has chosen an independent path, he is clearly disappointed that there has not been greater support for his work and his city.
When we started, at least when I started, I thought that there would be the beginning of a response through a number of things, finances, corporations, people, and so on and on. That hasn't happened. And part of the reason is that I'm not exactly advocating the American dream, quite evidently, from the very beginning. So it's very difficult to go to someone and say, well, you are mistaken, I'll tell you what the truth is, give me money. Doesn't work that way.
Some have been quick to dismiss Arcosanti and to brand Soleri's far-reaching ideas as visionary, but unachievable. Soleri, however, is not ready to give up.
Given the means that we had, which were just the means that we developed ourselves, I think we achieved quite a bit. I wish things were different, because of all the financial power existing, what we are seeking is such a tiny, tiny, bit that it's irritating not to be able to get it. If I have a regret, is that I'm not being used by society at all. So I think that's been a waste.
While Arcosanti struggles to become a prototype arcology, several other architects are applying similar ideas in their work. These creative designers also recognize the imperative of designing and planning urban growth in a more integrated and intelligent way.
The idea is valid, and it was valid 30 years ago when Paolo was a crackpot. And it's valid now, even more so, when all his ideas are starting to come together. And there's so many aspects, so many parts of what Paul has talked about that are happening. Recycling and energy awareness and pedestrian access and cultural activities, that all the parts are there. They're all there, they're out there in the society, and they haven't been pulled together. To me, it all seems so obvious that if you tie all these in together under the concept of arcology, that is going to work.
As cities around the planet reach unprecedented sizes, their increasing social and environmental problems must be addressed if we are to avoid catastrophe. Through arcology, Paolo Soleri has proposed a new type of city, one that he believes will prove to be more sustainable.
I think you'll see it in kind of bite-sized pieces. Because we are all individual decision makers, we are not going to take our resources and buy a house, for example, that isn't in some way or another connected with something that we identify as the norm, because it's too risky for us. So I think the real question is, do we have time to let bite-sized steps make those decisions?
Despite the obstacles, rejections, and disappointments, Soleri tenaciously holds to his philosophy. There is renewed interest in ecology, and people from around the world continue to be inspired by his ideas.
I think 10 years from now, I want people to say that the real opportunity was there, that the effort was made, that not everything worked, but we learned a lot and are able to live together better as a result of our participation in this project. I know that Paolo Soleri knows nothing is the final answer. but this is probably the boldest experiment in urban living on the planet today. And I'd like to just say that we gave it a good shot.
A lot of people probably living in single-family areas, living in suburbia, says, oh my gosh, I can never think of myself living in that type of environment. But all the different features they want, privacy, cultural facilities, closeness to retail facilities, closeness to libraries, closeness to city services and that, all can be provided in that particular environment. And that's what Paolo Saleri is proposing in his concept that he's been developing at Argos Santi.
Although Argos Santi is far from complete, Saleri trusts in the validity of his ideas. He perseveres, dreams, designs, and slowly builds, believing that one day his arcology will be built.
No, if I had the price that we put into an airplane was given to us for some reason, that we would have an arcology. Well, that's not possible, evidently. So we are trying to do what we can, and with the means we have, and with the know-how we have, which is very limited in many ways. So we're not very professional in any direction, but that's part of the pioneering, non-professionalism. So we are pioneering, and we'll see.